So we've got a bus on the other side of the security gate at Jenin, and we're heading off down through the West Bank today.
There's the boy. Passing through Jenin.
So we're at Dothan. It's a plain which is at the centre of several valleys, one of them leading from Megiddo, which would be over here, and the other leading down towards Shechem, is over here, and that's the Tell over in the distance. So we're at Sebaste, which is Samaria of old, built by Omri after he reigned 6 years in Tirzah. He reigned 6 years in this city. He built it on a hill, the hill brought from a man called Shema, which gave its name Samaria. When he died, Ahab replaced him and built a huge ivory-tipped palace here, and then brought Jezebel to it. We're going to do a 360 degree from the top of the hill of Shema, Samaria, Sebaste as it's called today. We're looking east. We're now looking south. We're now looking west. There's the man that sells coins. Now looking north.
So here we go. Did you get it?
So this is the city wall of ancient Shechem. Just been to several sites here between Mount Ebal on the north and Mount Gerizim on the south. We visited what's alleged to be Jacob's well, which we don't know whether that's true or not, but it most likely is. The well that Jacob dug would have been much deeper down below where we were, so the accumulation of rubbish and buildings over time raised it to a higher level. That's why it's that small little thing. It was probably a much bigger surround to the well that Jesus sat upon in John chapter 4. We then had a brief look at what's alleged to be Joseph's tomb. Of course, that's probably nonsense too, but it's got to be somewhere in this area that Jacob had his inheritance that he gave to his son Joseph. And we've had a look at what remains of the old town of Shechem, and that was very interesting. And you could see from the town of Shechem just how close Mount Gerizim and Mount Ebal were, and how it would be quite possible to have half the nation on Mount Gerizim and half on Mount Ebal. Now, we would normally read from the record of Deuteronomy. I'm just going to read briefly from Joshua chapter 8, where the requirement that was made twice in the book of Deuteronomy that Israel come up here and make a covenant before Yahweh and shout the blessings and the cursings of the law from these two mountains. I'm just going to read what happens in Joshua chapter 8, because when they took Ai eventually, and shortly, God willing, we'll be down at Ai in Bethel. When they took Ai, the record says this in verse 29. And the king of Ai, he hanged on a tree until eventide, and as soon as the sun was down, Joshua commanded that they should take his carcass down from the tree, cast to the entering of the gate of the city, and raised thereon a great heap of stones that remaineth unto this day. Then, this is the very next verse, verse 30, then Joshua built an altar unto Yahweh, God of Israel, in Mount Ebal. Now they're way down at Ai, they go back to the camp at Gilgal, and he calls on the whole nation of 2 million people to up stakes, take up their tents, and move the whole nation up here. Now we know the whole nation's up here because it tells us that at the end of this chapter, Joshua 8, there was not a word of all that Moses commanded which Joshua read not before all the congregation of Israel, with the women and the little ones and the strangers that were conversant among them. So they were all here, the whole nation. Now the logistics of that are incredible. Pick up the whole nation from where they've been for quite a considerable time and bring them all up here to Shechem. Why would you do that? Well, they did it because Yahweh required it of them, and they did it because of the importance of this place, Shechem. Now, you're all aware that the very first time we meet Shechem, of course, is in Genesis 12. Shechem means the shoulder or the neck between the shoulders, the place where you bear burdens, and therefore it came to be a representation of government. That's why in Isaiah 9 verse 6 we read of our Lord Jesus Christ that the government should be upon his what? Shoulder, Shechem. Alright, so it has to do with responsibility. Making decisions to accept responsibility is the key idea of Shechem. And whenever you read of Shechem, as you are well aware, that is what is in focus. People being brought to a position where they have to make a decision about something, what direction they're going to take. So here at Shechem, half the nation was on this mountain, Gerizim. As you can see, it comes down here to the valley, and half's on Ebal. And they shouted the blessings and the cursings of the law across this valley, and the whole nation would say, Amen. And they were brought into a covenant with their God here in this place, committing themselves
to do that which was right, that they might receive the blessing, and not to do that which was wrong, that they might get the cursing. So that's what happened here in Joshua chapter 8. Let me just read briefly what happens. It says, verse 32 of Joshua 8, "And he wrote there upon the stones a copy of the law of Moses, which he wrote in the presence of the children of Israel." They were all watching it. "And all Israel and their elders and officers and their judges stood on this side the ark of that, on that side of the ark before the priests, the Levites, which bear the ark of the covenant of Yahweh, as well the stranger." So we're included in this. There were Gentiles there representing us in the scheme of things. "As he that was born among them, half of them over against Mount Gerizim," we're standing on it now, "and half of them over against Mount Ebal," we're looking across the valley towards it, towards the north, "as Moses, the servant of Yahweh, had commanded before, that they should bless the people of Israel." And afterward he read all the words of that book. And so I'm going to say about Shechem, you could say a whole lot more. But let's just relate this to John chapter 4, because our Lord Jesus Christ came to Sychar. He came and he sat upon the well of Jacob, as you know. You see, John 3 and 4 set forth the divine pattern. The Lord tries to convert Nicodemus and ultimately, of course, succeeds. He came to the Jew first. Most of them would not respond. But the record of John 4 says he must needs go through Samaria. Well, of course, that's ridiculous. If you're going to go from Galilee to Jerusalem, you don't automatically choose this path across the mountains of Israel. He's going to go, of course, from Jerusalem north. You don't choose this path. Normally the Lord would go down the Jordan Valley. It's a much easier way to go. And that's why he goes down to Jericho, remember, and comes up from Jericho later on towards the end of his life. So when it says he must needs go through Samaria, he has a purpose in so doing. This is about the redemption of the Gentiles. And Samaritans were regarded by Christ as Gentiles. We read that in the Gospel of Luke. So, when he comes to this place and sits on that well, he's in the inheritance of Jacob, sitting on the well of Joseph, of Jacob, in the inheritance that had been given by Jacob to Joseph. Well, back in Genesis 34, you know what happened. Dinah came from that inheritance. She went into the city of Shechem. She was defiled by the prince of that city, by that name. And ultimately, of course, Levi and Simeon led the sons in the destruction of the men of Shechem. You know what happened? When they went to that city to destroy these men who had just been circumcised 3 days before, you know where they found Dinah? They found Dinah in the house of Shechem. Now, that was my daughter. There'd be no way. If she's been defiled by this man and they're getting themselves organized, there's no way she's going to be living with the man who's defiled her. But she was. You know why? Because she wanted to be there. Dinah did not want to be part of the family of Jacob. She had to be forced out of that situation. And we meet Dinah again. We meet her in John chapter 4. You know, there was a family of the Samaritans called the Dinaites. Yeah, Dinaites. You know how often the name Dinah occurs in the scripture? 8. How many times the word water occurs in the story of John 4? 8. How many times that the word didomi, which means to give or gave, occurs in that story of the woman of Samaria? 8. What's 8 the number of? It's the number of a new beginning that leads to immortality. And our Lord Jesus Christ was going to offer her water. She couldn't get out of that well. And you know the story very well, don't you, as to what happened. And he leads her progressively to the point where this woman is converted. And not only her, she goes back into the city and she calls out her fellow Samaritans. And they are converted, many of them. You know how long Jesus remains in that place doing this work? 2 days. 2 days. Yes. And from that time, for 2 millennia, he's been at work amongst the Gentiles as well. And you and I are included in that work. The story of the woman of Samaria starts with reference to the inheritance that Jacob gave to Joseph. Joseph means the increaser. That story ends with the Samaritans saying, "This man is the savior of the world." Joseph had an Egyptian name, and that name was Saphnath-Paneah, which means, in Egyptian, the Saviour of the world. And so he was. And that's why when Christ has his disciples come to him, and they've got food, and they offer it to him, he says, I have got meat, food to eat that you know nothing of. See these fields? They are white to the harvest. Here's the increaser. Here's the Saviour of the world, who remained there 2 days in order to bring in Gentiles into the faith. And he's still doing it. But the time is short. The time is very short. That work will come to an end. So we are privileged to be here, aren't we, today? Standing on this mountain, the mountain of blessing. Let's hope that we get the blessing and not the mountain of cursing. Let's hope we don't get the cursing. And the day is at hand when we're going to see the woman of Samaria and many of those Samaritans with us in the kingdom of God. That will be a wonderful time. Shechem. Shechem's all about responsibility. Let's make sure we continue to bear those responsibilities to the end of the time given to us. This is Shiloh.
If there be among you any man that is not clean, by reason of uncleanness to chance of him by night, then shall he go abroad out of the camp, he shall not come within the camp. It shall be when evening cometh on, he shall wash himself with water.
So here we are, nearly 3:30 in the morning, heading through the Jaffa Gate. So here we are loading the bus to go to Ben Gurion.